is a fairy story. It's about a child, really. It's about a child who feels afraid of the future and afraid of what's happening around him and afraid of what's happening with his parents and afraid of what's happening in the world. And the fairy story starts to take place, and the fairy story is the way that the child Hogarth in the story deals with those difficulties. It's not unlike Tommy, and it's also not unlike Quadrophenia in a way, which was also a day in the life of a kid, you know, trapped in a teenager's body. I've always tried to write definitive fairy tales, even in the songs that I've written. If there's a character, I've always tried to write in a fairy tale way, because I think it's the highest art, writing fairy tales. You know, I think the great stories of our time are all fairy tales. If you can do it, it's wonderful. And I think Ted's done it with The Iron Man. He's created a fairy tale. When I was a little kid, when I was about, not that little, when I was about 10, 11, I used to have to walk a long, long way to school. It felt like a long way, like about 5 miles or 4 miles or something. And it was an interminable walk, and it took me through a couple of neighbourhoods that were quite strange for various reasons. One was a kind of rough neighbourhood, and, you know, like, kids would leap out of the bushes and beat you up for no reason. And another thing was I used to have to go past the houses of two or three girls. One has never been enough. Two or three girls that I was passionately in love with. And I was afraid of meeting them, you know, because of the way it would make me feel. I would get very, very shy or whatever. So walking to school was this terrible kind of nightmare. You know, it might, you know, what might happen? I mean, you know, I might meet Diane or whatever her name is, and she might actually want to talk to me, and how will I deal with it? Or you know, Fred Spiggins, the mad school bully, will come out and demand my box of sherbet lemons or what. And I imagined this iron body that I had. I imagined that I'd invented this iron body in which I walked to school. And it was very much like this chap, you know, with me inside it. And I only remembered that after I decided to work on the story. So I think there are certain things about the story which are very, very personal to me, but personal to me as a child, not as an adult. And I'm just hoping that other people will pick up on those, you know, they'll have similar points of reference.
How does the author Ted Hughes feel about all that's happening with the Iron Man?
When we began the project, we began together, and we had two or three meetings when we discussed how it might grow. And then I went away waiting for him to produce a dramatic scenario, which he said he was going to produce. He'd done some work with Peter Brook. And anyway, it never came. He went fishing a couple of times and it never came. And rather than nag him, I put one of my own together and I sent it to him. And then we met and we talked about it. And he liked a lot of the ideas that I had. I decided that the story had to have a strong female image in it. So I went for the space dragon to start with. And I decided to make the space dragon a creature who had trapped the souls of children under her wings. And some of the images like that, he just responded to immediately. But I suppose he responded to them because, you know, he felt, hey, my story has sparked off all this wonderful imagery, you know.
So when did you actually want to turn the book into an album, and maybe even a musical, I hear, is on the cards?
Yeah, well, I started, and I still have this great desire to write a musical. I mean, I've written a musical, and the album that I'm releasing now is just 12 songs, 12 pieces, which are from the musical. So in a sense, you don't get on the record, you don't get a real feeling of the musical, because all of the musical bits have been taken off. There are comedy songs, there are sort of dance sequences, there's an overture, a prologue, an epilogue, there's a lot of stuff with conversation, you know, like not like opera, but, you know, the kind of things where there are musical conversations going on and stuff. And I wrote all that first. It took me a long time, it took about 2 years. And then I decided that it would be preposterous to put out a double album. Like Chess, I think they did it on Chess. They put out the whole musical on tape, and then they waited to get the money to do the musical itself. And I suppose I was following that route to some extent, and then I thought, what I'll do is I'll just put out a record, let people hear the songs, and if they like the songs, and if there's somebody out there that wants the musical, they scream loud enough, I'll give it to them. So I started really wanting to do a musical because I went to a few musicals and I liked them. I liked the theatre. I liked the comfort of going to nice theatres, and I liked the way that some musicals that I'd been to see, like Starlight Express and like Les Miserables and like Phantom of the Opera and stuff, seemed to have moved into the 20th century, but the music hadn't. You know, with Starlight Express, you had really quite old-fashioned lyric writing, you know, kind of... the music, very kind of corny rock. In Les Miserables, you've got that kind of French cafe music, and Phantom of the Opera is just Andrew Lloyd Webber's idea of mock opera. I'm not a great fan of musicals. I really, you know, by rights, I shouldn't really be working on them. When you're sick and afraid, and there's danger around, take a big can of spade and cut into the ground. Cut into the ground. Away from the light, away from the sound. Make a trap for the beast, dig his burial mound. Dig his burial mound. Dig for your life, dig to the death. Dig for salvation till your very last breath. Dig for protection.
So let's talk about some of the guests on the album. I mean, Roger's on there, Roger Daltrey, names like Nina Simone and John Lee Hooker. Tell us about that.
He was very interesting to work with because he can't read, and so he had to do the whole thing line by line, and I thought, you know, this just isn't going to work. But when you thread it all together, it just sounds like a performance. He didn't really know what to make of it, I don't think. He sort of regarded it as pop music, not blues, which of course it is compared to the kind of blues that he plays. But John Lee Hooker is the first blues performer that I ever thought, that's what I want to do. That, you know, it's that. It was that the stutter on My Generation was a direct acknowledgement of the stutter that on John Lee Hooker records, which lo and behold, is he still has. You know, he's 70 years old and he still stutters like a teenager. And that wild guitar sound that I was always groping for, you know, he was one of the first guitarists ever to use an electric guitar by putting a pickup, a microphone inside the guitar. The first recording I've got of John Lee Hooker's 1942. You know, and this guy is kind of saying, is that all right, Pete? You know, and I thought, he's saying my name. Because he's like a hero, you know, an absolute hero for me. And Nina Simone, extraordinarily enough, the other quite weird thing was actually playing her the demo, having her work, and then thinking, I must go in and tell her that she doesn't have to copy me. And I'm thinking, no, it's the other way around. It's me that's been copying her for years and years and years. And it was just really quite strange that I was able to almost to imitate her exactly on the demo that I was going to give to her, so that all she had to do was just sing it, and it would just sound like her. And I also worked with another great girl, a girl called Deborah Conway, who's with an Australian band called Do Re Mi, and she's a star. I mean, I don't know why she's not an enormous star. Stunning girl, and great voice in the old rock tradition, kind of got a Jennifer Rush type voice, which you don't hear in the band that she works with.
And Roger Daltrey, how is he about taking some direction from you?
Oh, yeah, in the end, we went back to our old collusive roles. You know, I went out to the canteen and came back, and he said, I've done it. It's done. It's down, you know.